long stay at Fitzsimmons Hospital in Denver nears its end as Mrs. Eisenhower and Senora Armas join the President and President Castillo Armas of Guatemala for pictures of the first state visit the President has had since he was stricken with a heart attack 48 days previously. The President looks rested and dapper despite his long siege of illness. President Armas presents the chief executive with a presidential seal worked by nuns in a Guatemalan convent. The president, as he admires the seal, looks forward to the following 24 hours when he will board his plane for a return to Washington and a long rest at his Gettysburg farm. In the meantime, he resumes his role of good neighbor. Restoration of Sultan Ben Yusef as reigning head of Morocco after 2 years of exile brings scores of Moroccan dignitaries to the Henri IV Pavilion in Paris. Wires and letters of congratulations pour into the man whose nationalist leadership brought partial self-rule to his country. Shortly before his triumphal return to the capital, the Sultan makes peace with the ranking officials of the French government and receives the homage of his followers. Glaoui, Pasha of Marrakesh, crawled to kiss the feet of the man in whose ouster he joined the French. The Pasha receives the forgiveness of the man, who is now the most powerful figure in Morocco. Honest John points his nose skyward over the slope of Mount Fuji. An interested but non-committal audience of Japanese villagers looking on as the Army readies one of the first public field tests of the new frontline rocket launcher. A communist-inspired protest against the test firing fizzled earlier in the day, and all goes smoothly in Honest John's debut, the first rocket ever fired over the sacred mountain of Japan. A perfect shoot, a good omen. At Fort Baker, California, three turncoats held for court-martial are freed under a Supreme Court decision in another case. Louis Griggs, William Cowart, and Otho Bell are the former Korean POWs who defected to Red China, were dishonorably discharged, and on their return seized by the Army. Now their lawyers bring the news that the law under which they were held, providing for the court-martial of military offenders after discharge, is unconstitutional. Civilian trial is still a possibility, but as of now, they're free men. Vice President Nixon doffs the fireman's hat, and in the presence of little Sandra Sterling, a victim of muscular dystrophy, is made honorary member of the International Association of Firefighters by President Redmond. The ceremony points up the Thanksgiving March for Muscular Dystrophy, America's firefighters once again volunteering their services to enlist our support. The Russian embassy celebrates the 38th anniversary of the Bolshevik Revolution with a gala caviar and vodka party. Watchful eyes out of the past follow the proceedings as Soviet Ambassador Georgi Zarubin extends the glad hand to the guests. It's the first big bust out of its kind here since the Russians began making with the big smiles. But reflecting perhaps the latest communiques from Geneva, which tell the old story of Russian scowls, not one American VIP showed up. Miss quite a spread, all the latest mouth-watering decadent capitalistic delicacies. Lenin would hardly recognize his revolution at this freeloader's paradise. Gourmets of the world, unite. What, no strawberries, comrade? Donald Campbell's jet-propelled Bluebird, which sank following an unsuccessful attempt on the world's record a few weeks back, tries again on Lake Mead. The Britisher, whose record is 202 miles an hour, came within a hair's breadth of shattering the mark the first time around. And now he gives her the gun again. His odd beetle-shaped craft zooming forward to challenge the theoretical water barrier standing between it and a new world's record. The racing son of a racing father hurtles across the water at a speed no other man has ever attained. Johnston, president of the Motion Picture Association, asks you, the audience, for your views and your cooperation.
Many of you in this audience have recently voted in state and local elections in your community. Now I want to tell you about another election, a national election, the Audience Awards. I want to tell you about it because I hope that you will participate in it. This is the election that gives you, for the first time in history, the opportunity of voting for your favorites in motion pictures. The polling place is the theater. The ballots are awaiting you. You can vote in the theater at any time from November the 17th to November the 27th. You will vote for five things on the ballot. First, the best picture of the year. Second, the best performance of an actor. Third, the best performance of an actress. Fourth, the most promising male personality. Fifth, the most promising female personality. I hope that you will use your ballot at the polling place. This time, it is up to you to choose your favorites, and I hope that you will go to the polls in the millions to select them.